welcome to another video podcast from tallbridgeguy.com. Today I just want to talk a little bit about a bridge I designed. Bridge in Keosauqua, or a really big river. This is the original bridge. It was a bowstring arch. You can see a little gentleman on top here. I'm not sure why he's up there, but it's 1873. That bridge had signs on it that read, $8 fine for riding or driving faster than a walk across the bridge, a $25 fine for any person to drive more than 20 head of cattle over the bridge at one time. That was replaced in 1939 with a, at that time, a better truss, a camelback truss, I think it's called. And you can see the limestone piers and the top of the pier caps were widened. So these are the original piers from the first bridge in 1873. The pier cap was widened to accommodate this new truss. Another view of it. So we had a choice. We could rehabilitate and try to make the bridge usable. It was getting old. Some of the problems are like the piers didn't have steel in them, so it was hard to figure out how much load they can carry. The whole bridge was covered in lead paint, so if we were going to repaint the bridge, we'd have to cover it and protect any lead from falling in the river. Here's a couple of the bearings, and you can see that it's starting to wear some of the paint off. There was a lot of unknowns on this bridge, so it was decided to replace the bridge. Here's another picture of the bridge. It had low clearance, 14 feet. You know, typically you'd like at least 16 feet of clearance on a major roadway. The sidewalks that are cantilevered off the sides, you can see down here in the corner, they started having wood over the sidewalks because there's great big holes. The concrete was wearing away. People were not safe crossing the bridge. This truss kept getting hit. There was a road that came from the side here, and they turned, the trucks would turn in here, and they'd hit the truss, and sometimes we have to close it down then. Here's an overhead view of the situation, and one of the things was the detour. The problem was, if we were going to just knock the bridge down and build a bridge, there was a 22-mile detour, and they were worried about safety vehicles getting to this side of the river, and so we had to stage construct the bridge. I came up with a quick cross-section. Typically, in our state, we have a 40-foot wide cross-section, but I got approval for a 32-foot wide cross-section so that we could put a big bike trail on one side and a pedestrian walkway on the other side. It's a little narrow, the 5 feet, but it meets ADA and all the different requirements, and I got to have two sidewalks, essentially, on the bridge. Steel girders spaced at 11'7". And construction started. So this is the old bridge. We left it in place so that they could use it while we built the first stage of the new bridge. Then we'd use the first stage of the new bridge for traffic and knock this ridge down and widen back towards the old bridge. But it was great. The seniors and other onlookers got to watch the construction of the new bridge. So they have to build cofferdams in the river so that they can get my footing for my piers in. And they built a causeway and they started building cofferdams so that they could drain the water. You can see the cofferdam during the winter. There's a pump to pump all the water out. That's what it looks like inside the cofferdam. They had some equipment, and the way that our piers worked on this, they're aesthetic piers, so they had to be a certain height and a certain depth. We couldn't just stop if we found really good rock. We actually had to go to a certain depth to make sure the pier would actually fit in the location. Didn't look like a fun job in the middle of winter to be stuck in icy cold water using, a jackhammer on the limestone. Eventually they found the limestone to be quite hard, so they got some dynamite, and I'm not too sure about these two guys, but they did blow up inside the cofferdam for the second pier. This is the steel work for the first pier. You can see them climbing up. The pier was about 25 feet high inside the cofferdam. The river is being held back. Bringing in the formwork for the first pier, you can see that we had texture in there so that we get a kind of a limestone face on the pier that we're going to paint later to make it look like limestone. Close up of the pier, the formwork for the pier. And we had some vertical stripes that we actually thought would be great for water lines to measure how high the river is going to be. The pier is done, and we mimicked the original pier. We put on a ice guard on the front. You can see with the vertical lines, they sort of give you a sense of how deep the river is at any one time. And you can see how tall it is, right? It's a 25-foot high pier. Pouring the second pier, you can see down inside some men working inside as they're pouring the concrete. That shovel, there's a guy's helmet down there, a person there. I think there's someone over here. Just for fun, I threw in my design pencil in the pier, so my pencil that I designed this bridge with is forever in the pier. I was just hoping it didn't show up in the face so someone could see it and we had to chip it out. But it turned out all right. There's the first pier. Eventually we're going to put a nose cone on it, and I'll show you that a little bit later. But it kind of mimics the same as the old pier, the limestone face, and the ice guard. Putting in the first three girders for the first stage. Tightening up all the bolts. That's a lot of bolts. So here's a side view. The two piers are in place. It's a three-span bridge, 210, 260, 210. This girder is about 12 feet deep here and 6 feet deep at the center line. And you can see that it kind of looks funny, the roadway. Well, you have to design it so when you put the weight on it, of course, it sinks to the road grade you want. But I had a really odd grade. I was coming down from the hill, so I have a bit of a sag curve. Then it's flat for a while, and then it's got a positive curve on this end. So it was a kind of a tough thing to detail for steel. Putting the formwork on top so they can pour the deck. We also put drill shafts in the abutments. There was some concern. There's some historic structures around the end of the bridge, and we didn't want to drive piles to make vibrations that could hurt the Hotel Manning, which is nearby. So we did a test shaft of a drill shaft just to see if we can get all the strengths that we want before actually putting in the drill shafts for the bridge. Plus, we just wanted to learn some things. Here's one of the abutments, and you can see the texture. That's the limestone texture, and we're going to paint that, stain it. Here's a little support for one of the light poles at the end of the bridge. Some of the decorative railing that's going to be on the bridge. We had our painter come out and try to paint this so it'd give it a limestone look, and we'd of course check and make sure that's what we wanted. Excuse me. And it involved a lot of little hand painting. But the pier is starting to look like limestone, and the paint system, the stain system, is supposed to last 10 to 15 years and give it a really good look. Here's the first stage. You can see we built it off. And the road is actually going to come down and eventually just curve slightly onto the bridge and then curve slightly back onto the main roadway. And we couldn't figure out any way to make it so that we replace this bridge while allowing people to use this structure at the same time. You can see our dilemma, right? If you want to leave this open so people can use the roadway, you have to build to the side. So we built the first three girders and then we'll widen back towards the bridge. Putting the epoxy-coated rebar down for the bridge. First stage is complete, and so we can start knocking down the old bridge. You can see the first stage. And we had to keep quite far away because, they, remember, there's piers sticking out, there's cantilevers, you needed working room, everything, so you did not damage this bridge. It's a little further away than I would have liked, but we wanted to keep clear of the old bridge. We also thought eventually when the new bridge was in place, there's going to be a curve coming down the hill, so you'll be offset a little bit, same as this side of the road. But this hill, you come down at 45 miles an hour, and there was some feeling that if we had an offset alignment, it may slow the traffic down a little bit as it comes into the town. It also could cause some accidents, but I'm hoping it slows the traffic down. There's the old bridge being torn apart, and you can see this is the cap that they put on in 1939 on top of the old 1873 piers. And the reason you can't stage typically, well, before I get to that, I'll just say we tried to use all the limestone from the old bridge as river protection for the new bridge, so we kept it in place. And there's some gentlemen taking a souvenir, part of the railing. But what I was going to talk about is you can't really stage a truss because once you cut down one side, there's no truss to carry the loads. So a truss is really difficult to stage if you can even do it. there's what my bridge looked like before all the railing was put on it. My friend crawled into the trees and took a picture of it. And you can see the nose cones on it, and I'll explain those in a little bit. Now the old bridge is gone, and they put on the two girder sections on the back side of the bridge. And you can see that they've protected the pier from any drainage from the weather steel girders, because the whole point of weathering steel is to have a patina on the outside that protects the girders from rusting on the inside. But rain, water, anything like that will, you know, wash some of this patina off onto the pier, and it's tough to get off, so you got to protect it. Under the bridge, you can see a little bit of the protection too, so the drainage doesn't get on the bridge. Some of the water lines, you can see how they're affected, and the limestone colored piers. Now I've got the nose cone back on the piers now, and the whole point of this is right on the top, we took blocks from the old pier and we had them worked by a craftsman, and they're going to be pieces of the old bridge that you can touch as you walk along the bridge. So it's a nice feature. This bridge flooded like three or four times during construction. You can see sometimes they had some problems getting their rebar out of the river. I guess you shouldn't leave it in the river. Another flood hit. A big ice dam upstream broke and hit the bridge, and I was really glad it didn't move. But remember how tall that pier was. It was 25 feet tall, and it's all underwater now. The bridge got hit by a big ice flow, and I'm sure glad it didn't slide off the bearings. These are pot bearings, not pot bearings. You got me. I just forgot the word. See? Should remember how to do these things. Be put on disc bearings. Sorry. Here's some of the outcroppings for the light poles, the new railings put on. And here's the final bridge. There's the Hotel Manning. There's the pier. And you can walk down this or drive your bike down this 10-foot bike path. And on top there's a little stone that you can touch the old bridge. And there's some monuments from the old bridge, revetment from the old bridge. Seems like a nice structure, and I think it's really working for the city. All right, well, that's all I have for this podcast, and I hope